much, Lorraine, and I hope your hearts have been strangely warm as you were sharing that song with us. And God does deserve all of our praise and all of the glory indeed. Well, this is the very first Sunday of Advent, so we are going to begin our message by looking at the indescribable gift. In fact, there's just one verse that we're going to be looking at this morning, but it's packed with a lot of meaning, and we're going to unpack it together as a congregation. That verse comes from 2 Corinthians 9:15. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. That's exactly how the verse puts it. But let me ask this question. Have you ever at Christmas time received an indescribable gift? You open it up and you look at it and it's like, what is this? And yet you gotta put a smile on your face because you're in that kind of position where all the doting relatives are hanging over your shoulder just waiting for your reaction. I think there's times you and I have opened up gifts and we get lost for words trying to describe the very gift we received. As someone perceptibly put it, Christmas is a season of emotional family ties, especially when you have to wear them. Now, I am sure that over the years, my wife has received some pretty indescribable gifts from her husband. Fortunately, however, as not to mar my fragile esteem, she always puts a smile on her face. She looks at the gift and says, "Thanks, dear." Just what I always wanted. And I will be a little transparent. Early in our marriage, I tried to actually buy her clothes for Christmas.
Oh.
But that was a nightmare, to say the least. Because I never did really ask for her size. So by the time I got to the department store, the lady clerk that would wait on me would say, "Well, do you know her size?" And me being a man and who I am, I'm like, "No, I can't tell you." So she would say, "Well, is she my size? Is she bigger than I am? Is she smaller than I am?" I'm not answering that question. I mean, what is this? Death to Dad's Day? There's no way. There's no right answer to such a question. So needless to say, those days are over. And then one last thing before we take a look at this scripture text. There's one thing I despise on Christmas morning. Whether being a dad or even now, three words I cannot stand. Some assembly required.
What is
there is no way under heaven I can read time by needs. And usually the instructions come in that, right? And I do not have a PhD in mechanical assembly. I just want you guys to know that. Well, I did read, though, of a very interesting story of a man who actually ordered a playhouse, a treehouse, actually, kit for his kids. The kit came in, instructions were there for the treehouse, but all the parts were for a boat, not a treehouse. So the next day he calls the company because he's really livid. This was a Christmas gift. He wanted to put it all together and have it ready. And they were very sympathetic and understanding, but I have to read the reply. "We are truly sorry for the error and the inconvenience. However, it might cheer you up to remember that somewhere there's a man out on the lake trying to sail your treehouse." Well, believe it or not, I gained a new insight to Christmas as I was taking a look at this verse in 2 Corinthians. In fact, I developed four criteria when it comes to gift giving, especially when it comes to giving gifts to those that you love the most, that you truly have a heart for. God tells us that he gave us an indescribable gift. The New Living Translation says it this way: a gift too wonderful for words. So what can I pull out of that? What can you and I together glean from this? The first thing I want you to understand is a gift, if you're really concerned and love someone, the gift must be personal. I think it's very disheartening to receive a present that you know nobody put much time into. much thought into it. It doesn't even have a magic moment in that gift giving. Well, let me say this. One of the greatest gifts in life that you can receive, especially in this Christmas time, is the revelation and the realization that God Himself knows each one of us intimately and personally. And He wants us to know Him personally as well. In Psalm 139, verses 1 through 3, is a startling and beautiful reminder of this fact. It says this, Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. You know, if you're like me and you just stop and think about that for a moment, it is mind-blowing that God Himself, the God of the universe, wants to know us intimately. Which tells me He's not a mystical higher power like a lot of people want to describe Him. Instead, He is a God who wants to relate to you and wants to relate with me. He wants to relate to us on our level. Now, for the parents that are out here, or grandparents, well, let me just put it this way. Anyone who's picked up a baby and held a baby and put out their finger and had that baby grip a finger, isn't that a wonderful experience? But can I say this? When a baby grips your finger, I can't help but think it tugs at your heartstrings. There's no way you cannot love a baby when a baby has its hand wrapped around that finger of yours. You sense that love. Christmas is the powerful grip of a tiny baby reaching from the bed of straw. It is love tugging at our hearts back to God. As one has put it, God, invisible in His own nature, became visible in ours. Beyond our grasp, He chose to come within our grasp. This is the intimate, personal nature of Christmas. God gave His very Son a gift and offering for you and for me. John 3:16 puts it well. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but have eternal life. So the first thing I pull out of this is the gift ought to be personal. But the second thing I pull out of this is the gift also should be practical. Reminds me of a woman who once stuck her Christmas list on the refrigerator, hoping that her husband would actually see it and read it. I mean, she felt there's always that opportunity that he's going to open up that refrigerator door. And she kept it simply, brilliantly, to the point. Asking only for something that will make me look slim and beautiful. When Christmas arrived, she looked forward to opening a package with something gorgeously intimate inside. Instead, she got an exercise ball. Whoa, poor me. You know, I think oftentimes Santa might bring us things that we really didn't anticipate, but maybe they're things that we deserve. God, however, will live through something that you and I don't deserve. You see, the Bible says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So in essence, what is the practical gift that God gives us? It is life. And not only life, it is life abundant. We're all familiar with the Christmas story, I'm sure. We know that Jesus was born in the little town of Bethlehem. But did you realize that Bethlehem actually means the house of bread? Then later on in Jesus' own life, He makes this picture statement about Himself. I am the bread of life. Those who come to me will never go hungry, and those who believe in me will never be thirsty. I discovered that bread satisfies, but also it strengthens. Jesus is saying, I have come, even in a village called the House of Bread, to be the bread of life to you. I am the only one who can satisfy, But I go beyond that. I also can strengthen your life. And this isn't a gift that you and I ought to passively receive. End of story. It is a practical gift by its very nature, because when you receive Jesus Christ, His Spirit now dwells within you to help you live the kind of life, the abundant life that God desires. A life with joy and love and peace and gentleness and patience, self-control and humility. So we have a personal gift. We have a practical gift. But something else I discovered about gift giving, it's not always true when we give to one another, but wouldn't you like your gift to be a little bit more permanent? Kind of last more than just Christmas Day? I can't tell you the number of times we bought our kids something and thinking this is really what they want, they're going to be so blessed by it, later find that they're playing with the boxes and the wrapping paper. Or you give them a gift and they break it before they even discover how it's supposed to work, how the gift is supposed to function. My, oh my. And then last, you get everything just right, they open up on Christmas morning, and some words you don't like to hear, batteries not included. God gave us, however, a gift that is permanent and unperishable. It won't need to go back to the shop. Remember what we just read from the Gospel of John. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that everyone who believes in Him will not perish, but have what? Eternal life. But you have to believe. You have to come. You have to receive Jesus as your personal Savior. And think of a man who was trying to explain to his 3-year-old son that if he chooses to disobey mom and dad, he'll have to live with the consequences. Finally, there's this horrified look on the child's face. He says, "Oh, Daddy, please, please don't make me go live with the consequences. I want to live with you and Mommy." But the Bible's very clear. The wages of sin is death. And if we don't receive Jesus Christ, we face the consequences. If we don't obey God, we face the consequences. And one of those consequences is separation, eternally from God. God knows that we're all in danger of this. We're at risk of spending eternity separated from Him and the love that He so freely offers. So that's why God sent His Son, Jesus Christ. It was to give us the opportunity to experience this permanent gift of life, everlasting life. I assure you, Jesus said, those who listen to my message and believe in God who sent me have eternal life. You've heard the expression before, life without Christ is a hopeless end. The life with Christ indeed is an endless hope. And then the last thought I want to bring your way is the gift must be purchased. I really don't think my wife or any one of you in this room would appreciate a gift for me if you found out I stole it. I don't think that would sit very well, either in the family or in the congregation. Well, God's gift to us was a purchased gift. It did not come for free. In fact, it came at a huge cost. And you and I should never cheapen it by regarding it lightly. God gave us His only Son. We couldn't save ourselves, so God sent Jesus Christ to step in to redeem us and to save us. Now, I don't know how many here might have been lifeguards in your day. Maybe some of you still are. You got your certificate of being a lifeguard. But one thing I discovered, if someone is drowning, the lifeguards will go out to that drowning person and they will tread water there until the person gives up their struggle. If you try to grab someone who's panicked, who's struggling, who's trying to work it out itself, and you grab that person, they'll take you under with them. And so a lifeguard's learn to wait until the struggle's over, then they'll grab the person that needs protecting and needs rescuing and bring that person back to shore. Well, you know what? In the same sense, you and I cannot save ourselves. We try so hard, we paddle, we kick, we do everything we can to do life our way. But God says if you just relax and receive this gift I will rescue you. And he did that by paying the price through Jesus Christ. 1 John 2:2 says, he is the sacrifice for our sins. He takes away not only our sins, but the sins of all the world. We are saved by having faith in Jesus to rescue us. Not by thrashing around, not by trying to figure all out, not by doing life, as I said earlier, our own way. God spent everything he had on us. And the gift is one that we shouldn't want to exchange for anything else. But you know something? God never forces himself upon anyone. He offers the gift, but we don't have to take it. He's already reached out to us to demonstrate his love for us. But it's up to us to make that next move. It's amazing, simple. All we have to do is accept God's gift by simply believing in him. And the word believe dictates action on our part. And I put in your notes that the word means to commit or rely and depend upon. But in Scripture, it means far more than that. It goes far deeper than that. The word in Scripture, when it talks about believing, means to throw yourself upon the mercy and not let go. To throw yourself upon God's grace and grasp with all your might with no intention ever to allow anything to sever that relationship. I don't know if you've ever received gift vouchers for Christmas, but if you do, many of those vouchers will have an expiration date. In other words, unless you use it by a particular time, you lost it. The voucher's no good. But also, you can only use the voucher at the place where it needs to be redeemed. And if you don't redeem it, it also is no good. Well, the same can be said of our offer of salvation, of God's offer of salvation. There is an expiration date. Today is the day of salvation, and you can only receive it if you ask for it, if you ask him to come into your heart and life. You know, in 1978, I found myself standing before a minister, actually it was my wife's father, and he asked me the question, will you take this woman to be your lawfully wedded wife? And I'm looking like him, I'm like, are you a fool? Of course I'm taking her to be my lawfully wedded wife. She's the most beautiful woman in all the world to me. And I'm standing there just amazed at her beauty and thinking this question, like, what a crazy question. Yes, 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 and yes again. Then he turned to my bride-to-be and he asked Penny, now, do you take this man? And I'm thinking, ooh. She's got to respond as well. Maybe she's not as excited as I am. Maybe it's going to be a moment of hesitation. Maybe she's going to have to pause and say, let me think about it for a moment and I'll get back to you. But I am so glad at that occasion she also said, I do. And guess what? At that moment, through our own willingness, we expressed and commit ourselves to one another. And Penny and I entered a special, loving relationship that has forever and wonderfully changed our lives. The Bible says that God showed his great love for us by sending Christ to die for us. Just over 2,000 years ago, God gave an answer to the question of whether or not he is willing to enter into a loving relationship with you and with me. By coming to earth in the person of Jesus Christ, he gave us a resounding, yes, I do. I want to enter into that loving relationship. But now he puts the question to each of us. And if we answer, yes, I am willing to believe and receive Jesus Christ, we too will enter a relationship with God that will forever change our lives. I'm going to ask the praise team if they would come back to the platform. Because what it takes from you and I is to simply believe and receive this gift that Christ or that God offers. A personal, practical, permanent, purchased gift that can be yours. And it can be yours for life. These famous words were penned by Philip Brooks in 1867. They became the last verse of a very familiar Christmas carol, O Little Town of Bethlehem. The words go like this. O Holy Child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. O come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. Would you stand as we close in song and in invitation this morning?